Your vote. Power 102 FM. Here's journalist Tony Fraser.
Good afternoon to all our listeners. Whether you are listening on the radio or whether you are online, Steve.
We're online, power102fm.com. Those that downloaded our app, the iTunes or Play Store, to watch us as well.
All right. And did we hear that piece by Sparrow, Model Nation? Let me hear a little bit more.
Well, we played Model Nation.
Let's get a little,
bit in the background.
Population of our little nation is not a lot, but oh, what a mixture of races and culture, that's what we've got. Still no major indifference of race, color, religion, or finance. It's amazing to you, I'm sure, we didn't get independence before, which means Trinidad and Tobago will always live on. Colonialism. Our nation is for everybody. We will follow our leaders. They always do their best. Oh yes, we want to achieve. We're going to aspire. We're bound to be a success.
Slinger Francisco recording the time of independence, and we are talking Shagaramus. And of course, Shagaramus has been central to independence of Trinidad and Tobago. Dr. Williams and the brigade marched around the savannah in the rain to make claims to reclaim the Shagaramus Peninsula from the Americans who had used it during the war, and was exchanged with the British government for what Williams called 50 antiquated battleships, which were spread among Caribbean countries, Antigua and so on, and Trinidad and Tobago. Trinidad and Tobago didn't get them. They went to the British government for their wartime effort. Of course, it has significance for CARICOM. The CARICOM agreement was signed down there, and then you had the single market and economy. So it's central to Trinidad and Tobago and the Caribbean independence. We talked about this matter last week, and in the absence of the Shagaramus Development Authority, this week we have with us Kizzy Ruiz, who is the communications manager. Kizzy is, of course, no stranger to national audience. Welcome to the program, Kizzy.
Thank you for having me, Tony.
Maybe you'll get a song out of this for next year. Who knows?
Probably.
Peter Neptune, former colleague, now marketing manager of the CDA. Peter's gone to higher ground. I'm always glad for my colleagues when they get into something that rewards them. Welcome to the program, Peter.
Thank you for welcoming me.
And as we said, we've been talking about, especially, and there are lots of things about Shagaramus that we can talk about, the whole area and so on, but we're not talking about all of that today. Maybe we'll invite you back to talk about your plans separately, but we are focusing our attention today on the lease of the convention center and the lands surrounding. As I think I have read, it's 8 acres of land, and it's a 30-year lease to be returned to Trinidad and Tobago at the end of that period. So those are the things that I've picked up and read here and there and so on. You tell me what the story is. We're going to start with Kizzy, ladies first.
Well, the CDA provided a comprehensive document on the lease of the Shagaramus Hotel and Convention Center. And one of the main issues we wanted to highlight is
presented
that
it where?
It was a press release that was issued to all the media houses. It was well covered, and it stated the facts behind the Hotel and Convention Center, some of which I would go through with you. The main fact is that the Shagaramus Hotel and Convention Center was not sold, but it was leased. There was the belief it was sold. The Shagaramus Development Authority, we cannot sell land within the Shagaramus region. We have the power under the Shagaramus Development Authority Act to lease lands. All right. The Shagaramus Convention Center was in dire need of repair. And in fact, research data shows that we stood at a loss of $0.4 million annually. Another fact is it actually cost in excess of $200 million to refurbish and upgrade the property into a 4-star hotel. All right. A significant portion of the property is deemed unsafe and uninhabitable. And in fact, because of all these conditions, the property itself has been a financial burden on taxpayers for the past 15 years. In 2009, the Shagramas Development Authority at that time applied to Cabinet for $49 million to refurbish and repair the Shagramas Hotel and Convention Center. However, only $1 million was provided for refurbishment works, right? And the Shagramas Development Authority actually went through a stringent process in terms of finding an investor. So we would have followed due process. However, for some reason or the other, people would have felt that we did not. It's the belief that we did not. But based on my information, we would have sent out several RFPs.
Is an RFP?
Request for proposals. And we also included Investiti to help us in terms of getting investors on board. So we would have followed due process to get to this point. And it was all detailed in a very comprehensive press release, which stated all the information and the facts. And it was well covered in the media.
So would you say that these are the major items having to do with the lease of the convention center?
These were the major items that we highlighted, okay, which stated these were the problems that the Shagramas Development Authority had to face.
All right.
Under the Shagramas Development Authorities Act, one of the main aims of the CDA is to ensure that all our properties are used to the best interest of the citizens of Trinidad and Tobago, and the authority is mandated to monetize their assets to make sure it's not a burden to taxpayers. And as a result of that, a lot of our projects and our developmental plans would be to the benefits of citizens of Trinidad and Tobago, and to ensure the best use of the land and ensure that Shagramas is not a financial burden, and all our investment projects can help in terms of economic diversification and contributing to the development of Trinidad and Tobago.
Okay. So, anything you want to add to that, Mr. Neptune?
No, it sounds pretty
That sounds good. Now, if you consider these to be the major elements, they don't seem quite sufficient. Who are the investors? How will they return the property to the government after the 30-year lease? What are the terms and conditions to be determined by that? So let's start one by one. Who are the investors?
That information will actually be revealed in the future, and it will be revealed...
But don't you think... We're talking about national property.
Mm-hmm.
You know, recently, a government minister got into a tangle with a reporter about national property. And he said, well, that's private business and you don't have to know about that. We take a different view. The different view is that this is national property.
Mm-hmm.
We talked about the significance of Shagramas at the start of the program. This is not an ordinary piece of land. This is a significant portion of the country's heritage. And you don't, I consider these four items that you've talked about here really the tip of the iceberg. We need to know in detail, including who are the people who made proposals, how did the authority come to define and delineate 1, 2, 3. Those are the kinds of things that the country needs to know.
Mm-hmm.
The issue, for example, the process involved in selecting the investor is a very transparent one.
Mm-hmm.
And it starts with the RFP, as you know.
Mm-hmm.
And based on that, people locally...
Can you spell out there? There are lots of people outside that don't know what an RFP is.
So. A request for proposals.
Right.
That is an invitation that government and institutions make to the public and investors and interested people, persons who may be interested in a project or... a development.
Mm-hmm. And, so you put these proposals out in the public?
Yes.
In the public media?
Yes, in the public
what
media.
What period of time?
It has been available at least for a year and a half.
Mm. Take out ads in the newspapers and so on?
Oh, yes, certainly.
In fact,
certainly.
Tony, let me give you some of the details. On the 5th of February 2013, an invitation was issued in the public domain, Express Guardian and Newsday, seeking proposals for qualified and experienced developers and investors to refurbish the hotel and convention center. Right? The original advertisement provided May 31st, 2013 as the deadline. for submission of proposals. The deadline was further extended to the 29th of July 2013. Mm-hmm. A total of four companies expressed interest, but only one submission was received but did not meet the qualifying requirements.
Can we say who those four companies are?
Those names will be provided later on.
You see, that's the lack of transparency in what you're doing. This is not a personal property, you know. Why it's so difficult to talk about the companies that have made the overture? Why is it?
You see, Mr. Fraser, we have not asked those companies if they want their names to be public.
But if they are making a public bid, then it goes without saying that it's a public item. This is not private property. This is the property of the people of Trinidad and Tobago.
I agree it's not private property, but the office of the Prime Minister is owned by the public. But you cannot walk into the office of the Prime Minister and sit down in the Prime Minister's seat.
We're not trying to do that. We're saying
Until we speak with those people and ask them,
that's a very, very different thing, Peter. Come on, do you want to make some excuse? But don't say that. Who's trying to walk into the Prime Minister's office? We are saying public property is up for lease. Tell us who these people are and why they did not meet the criteria.
You see, the criteria was set very high in that we wanted to have...
That's fine.
Let me tell you the criteria.
Yeah, but are you going to follow up by saying who are the companies?
Well, I don't have them in front of me now because that question wasn't asked before. I can get that information for you.
No. Call somebody in
tomorrow,
your office.
You can get it.
Call somebody in your office and tell us.
Well, not when I'm on air. After air, I could do that.
But you should have been prepared. You came to a public discussion. I don't know what you expected me to ask of you.
What I'm giving you is all of the details about it.
Yeah. I feel a certain measure of sympathy to both of you. Eh? And I feel a little bad pressing you because I know you're not the decision makers. But they push you all in the heat, so therefore you have to take the heat. Mm-hmm. Because I have to answer to my public outside here, who will tell me that I have to demand answers. Yes. This is their property, you know.
Yes, their names
are patrimony of the
country.
Their
names are important, but what is more important is the process involved in selecting them.
Right. Yeah.
And I'm telling you what the process is so that you will understand
it. Okay, so tell us
what
the process is.
And those people who would have qualified at the end, including all those who did not qualify, they will know why they did not qualify.
Yes, but I'm sure that you've communicated that with them.
No, well...
Come on, you must.
There is a transparent process, and they were all told what the process will be in the beginning.
Come on, be transparent.
So I'm
telling you what the process is. Come on.
I don't know them.
Be transparent.
Because I never asked for them.
Be transparent.
So my concern was that the process was transparent.
They did not qualify. Have they accepted that they did not qualify?
Yes, they have.
Okay, fine.
Because honestly, they know who they are, and they would have come forward and say, look, I was not being fairly treated by the CBA.
Okay, fine.
And I did not get a fair shake in the opportunity to develop the hotel.
I give you that
for
the moment.
None of them has come forward.
I give you that for the moment.
All right.
Second phase. Where did you move? These four people applied. Could you say if they were local, regional, international?
I think they were local companies. And that is why the CDA has also adopted the approach of joint ventures.
Okay.
Because we want to ensure that our developmental plans also allow businesses in Trinidad to benefit.
Yes.
So say, for example, in the development of the hotel and convention center, while you might have the capital, you might not necessarily have the expertise in running a convention center.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the strategies that the CDA adopted is that we got an international agency to partner who has a wealth of experience in international hotel management, and they will partner with the investor.
And that's acceptable all over Trinidad. The Hyatt, the Hilton,
the investor himself is local, but the organization running it.
All right, so we're coming now to, you've brought me with that comment to the present investors or investor.
Yes.
Who are they?
That information we will provide.
I wish I could stand on my head.
You see,
you know, we've been doing this program for 2 weeks.
I have been patient
last week. I said they didn't come, and I was patient, and I allowed the farmers to say their piece. But you're pushing me beyond. You, meaning the CDA, is pushing me on beyond tolerance, acceptance. I have an audience. They're going to say, but Fraser feel that he's talking to himself. No.
No, but there's a process, and I think during the negotiating process.
Who are the local investors? Are they local?
It's a joint venture.
So it's local investors.
And international.
And some sheiks, is that so? I don't know why. I just go in by what I see in the papers. Is that
and
so?
And sometimes information in the papers could actually be inaccurate.
So that's why I'm asking.
It's not sheiks.
So who are they?
And that we will provide to you.
No, you see,
Mr. Fraser,
we're testing my patience.
No, we're not testing your patience.
Big time, you're testing
my
patience.
No, we're not testing your patience. But we will do due diligence and we will provide you with information.
You know, the point of all of this is that you have public property. Mm-hmm. This is a governance. This is about politics and about governance. You are disposing of public property, whether it's a lease or sale or whatever it is. You have to come to the population. This doesn't belong to the government. Doesn't belong to the CDA. Mm-hmm. Doesn't belong to Daniel Solomon and what's the lady's Hargraves. It doesn't belong to the minister. It belongs to the people of Trinidad and Tobago. And if you're going to dispose with the property of Trinidad and the people of Trinidad, you have to tell them. You have to front up. Yeah. In fact, before you reach agreement, you have to keep them in touch. That's the world of governance that we live in now. I didn't create it. That's how it is.
Yeah.
I understand that, and that is a good direction for the country to go in.
Mm-hmm. But CDA won't start the process.
No, I would not say so at all. The process is continuing with the investor, and when that process is completed...
What about the owners of the property?
Yes.
You're talking about
what
investors. We are talking about the owners. How much did you pay for this? How much did the investors pay for this?
It's $30 million.
What is that? $30 million over the 30 years?
No, I believe that there's going to be a monthly rental as well.
So this $30 million is what?
So a satisfaction fee? We granted a lease, mm-hmm. a 30-year lease at TT, $30 million in a lump sum premium payments. In addition to a rental payment of no less than TT 50K per annum.
What's 50K?
15,000, I believe, taken into consideration.
15?
Yes, 15, taken into consideration.
15,000?
Mm-hmm, K per annum.
You mean per year? $15,000 per year?
Per month.
Annum, I think annum means year. Am I crazy or something?
I think... Probably let me double check this figure for you.
Yeah, because, $15,000 a year.
Yeah.
That's sweetie money, my friend. For the owner of a four-star hotel.
Let me double check and make sure that figure is correct
of,
for you.
But, yeah, again,
I just
sorry.
Need to double check that for you.
Peter and Kizzy, I'm sorry that you are getting the brunt of it. Because I know you're not the policy makers. But how you could think about $15,000 a year for such property? If I rent in my house, which is a little shack, I want $15,000 a month, much more
but
for $15,000
you're ignoring that $30 million was paid
what
in advance.
What is $30 million? That's sweetie money you're talking about,
no,
a convention center.
Have you seen the property?
That doesn't matter.
Yes,
businessmen.
Mm-hmm.
Businessmen. What's his name,
you,
my good
you
friend?
You have to have...
Hold on, let me give you an example. Mr. Gailey, Alfred Gailey.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how much he paid for the Greyfriars Hall and Church.
Mm-hmm.
And he's going to knock it down. So the money paid up front is nothing. $30 million, that's sweetie money.
I would not say so at all.
8 acres of land, prime property.
That they have to spend a lot of money developing.
But that's their problem. They are getting into an investment.
When you are in business, uh-huh. you must have a deal where everyone wins.
They're winning too far, but
I wouldn't call that a very fair assumption of it.
They're winning too far.
That they're winning too far.
$30 million for 30 years, $1 million a year. $1 million a year. And then $15,000 a year.
You have to look at the present value of it. And in addition to that...
Absolutely.
The
present value of that land.
Right. In addition to that, it was reviewed.
I just want to interject to find out exactly what was it appraised at.
Right. It was reviewed and appraised by Pricewaterhouse and other agencies who provided their consultation on it.
Mm-hmm.
And they are suggesting that this is the way to go.
Right.
Based on the revenue flow that will come over the next 30 years.
But shouldn't that information to be outside there? I am not a land expert.
Yes, that information could be out there. But will you put that in the newspaper? Because it is...
Why not? It's people's property.
We have made it public and still people are not aware of it because apparently the newspaper don't think it's important
to give the facts of the issue. Peter, you're a communicator. And,
mm-hmm.
If you put information out there and people don't know, it's something is not wrong with them. Something is wrong with you and your communications.
I think the media has come to a point where the only sort of information that seems to be of any value is bacchanal information.
No, this is not bacchanal.
Hold on. We are getting to speak simply because somebody came up and said we give away the convention center and we sell it out. And the person who made that statement was quite aware that that was not true. And that is how we are at this point where we are talking about
but
it.
But even at these
only
figures...
Only when Bacchanal comes into it, then the
Peter,
facts come out.
Peter,
but
we
have been
you.
Making the facts available all the time since 2013 and 2012 when the ads was first paid out. And then we are being said it's a big secret. It's no secret. We have been looking for an investor for the hotel and convention
center. But it's still a secret.
For years.
You have come here year
because
after and you can't tell me who the investors are.
Because
it is a
until
secret.
The whole process is not completed,
uh-huh.
announcement will be made on that.
No, but as after
you
the fact.
You cannot talk about the details of a deal.
Why not?
Public. Like
it
if
is,
it's completed,
it is public.
Maybe we are still in the process of trying to negotiate more than $30 million.
Well,
but
say
if
so.
If a
is that what you're saying? Is that what you're saying?
I don't know. I'm just saying the process is not completed.
Then you're giving me
let the process complete first, and then announcement will be made on all
then
of
you're
it.
Giving me a 6 for 9, Peter.
No, but you are also doing
front.
The same thing by assuming that it is not transparent, while everything is showing that it is transparent
no,
and people
no,
are not.
No,
and
we don't know who
that.
The investors are.
That is the only thing you don't know, but everything
no,
else about
no,
it, you know.
You're not too sure whether it's 15K a month, whether it's a year. We don't know whether it's local or foreign. We know don't know plenty things.
No, but we told you it's a joint venture between local and international.
That's not sufficient.
We told you that.
Who are these people? I own
I'm
the local company.
All of your questions.
All right, who are these people?
When the due process is finished,
no,
you will get that.
That's
that is
not
the only
sufficient.
Question that has not been answered.
That is not sufficient.
But the process is transparent, and the process
addresses it is not transparent until we know. Kizzy went outside and got some information. Yes, tell us.
I'm trying to clarify the information on the 15K.
Yes. Uh-huh.
I am still getting that information to you, so I will try to get you as much information. That's how we're trying to show how transparent we are. So we're
you should have come with that. I don't know what you asked. You
but this was, as I said,
twiddly winks.
You see, in addition to that, we were talking about the requirements of the investor for the hotel.
Mm-hmm.
We are quite aware of the patrimony of this hotel.
Mm-hmm.
It means more to us than just a building with 80 rooms.
Yes.
It has a lot of history to go with it.
Yes.
And in regards to that, we have been speaking with the developer,
mm-hmm.
and telling them, look, if you want to develop this resource, you need to be mindful of the history of it, and you need to preserve it, because
yes.
it means a lot to Trinidad,
mm-hmm.
and to the Caribbean.
Yes.
And investors fell out when they heard that. We also told them, look, you need to invest in the communities, because
apart
the area right around Sagaramas, they need support and they need jobs. They need a lot of things.
Is the beach going to
get
be blocked off in front?
Most definitely not.
Okay.
And I'm
see
saying
information
that,
we don't know.
But that
so
has,
I'm asking
that has,
you know.
That has been up in written in press releases in
are we talking
all
about
over
March 7th. Today's the 7th?
Yes.
2015. And that's what we want to know today.
The beach will never be, even in the development of the third phase of the water park,
mm-hmm.
the beach will not be blocked.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, what we're doing is putting aside parking to make sure that people have parking and they have access to the beach.
Okay.
That is being said there.
Mm-hmm.
In addition to that, they are going to be fixing the seawall, rehabilitating it,
uh-huh.
and taking all the rocks out of it so that when you go there, it's going to be a beautiful scenery.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And my question is, suppose it is a Colombian drug dealer that you're dealing with. I'm not joking, you know, I'm deadly serious.
Mm-hmm.
We don't know. Suppose the people of Trinidad and Tobago have a problem with who these investors are, local and foreign.
You see, there were consultants involved in...
Consultants
selecting.
Are
listen,
not
listen,
the people
I'm
of Trinidad
your
and
question.
Tobago.
Let me answer your question.
Okay,
there are consultants involved in selecting... who will be developers of the hotel and all of the projects.
Mm-hmm.
And they will do background checks into these people to make sure that they have experience
but
in
we
running
must
hotels.
Know. We must
make
know.
Sure that they have the financial resources
Peter,
to do what they say they're going
Peter
to do.
Peter and Kizzy, I am sure
I don't
that
have to give you the names. When their name come out at the end, you will
you
know
sound,
it's not drug
you
Colombian.
Sound it, but then the deal is done. Then the deal is done.
But they would have met all the criteria that I would have
of
set to
whom?
You.
Of whom? The people of Trinidad and Tobago?
Yes, most they, certainly.
How?
Most certainly because
how, if they
the
don't even know who these
tells
are.
Us that we must secure the interests of the people of Trinidad and
yeah,
Tobago.
Yeah.
And that is what we are doing.
How many people?
And if we don't do that, and none of the deals that you have seen done in the Sagaramas area, you will see that it has not been done with the
how many
the
deals
people?
All around the world, Trinidad and Tobago included, have been done by governments all over the world without the information going to the people of Trinidad and Tobago. And in the end, they have found that those people's interests have not been fully served.
I cannot speak about those other governments all about.
I am sure that there is an example in Trinidad and Tobago.
CDA is very adamant on becoming an international organization.
Yes, yes.
And being an international organization requires a certain level of transparency,
yes.
And you will get that.
But in the how process are you getting transparency after the fact?
It also requires that we follow certain procedures that...
Established by whom?
International procedures established
international,
by UN and,
what about
and
the Trinidad
World Bank
Tobago?
And so on.
What
all
about
of those
the population?
People and the population of Trinidad
you know,
and Tobago.
If this was private
because we,
property.
And an ISO certification as well, there's a procedure
all of that is nice, pretty,
that.
You know. There
it's
were,
not pretty, it's
there were
real.
All kinds of certifications for the highway. And when the authority went, the set up by the senator, what's it, not set up, chaired by the senator, he found, Armstrong is his name, he found that certain criteria, all the pretty talk you're talking about, were not met. Were not met. I didn't invent that.
Mm-hmm.
And well, therefore, there has to, true transparency comes, not through this agency or that agency or the other agent, through the people of Trinidad and Tobago.
You see, if I sit down and ask everybody in Trinidad what they want to do with Chagaramas, you will get so many millions of different things that we ought to do. And what we are guided by is the act and the policy.
Democracy is not an easy thing to...
Yes, and we will make... And the information is the transparent approach to dealing with it.
Let me take you off. Let me take you off. Mr. Richardson?
Yes, I did.
Okay, we'll have him after.
And
listeners, one second. Mm-hmm. Listeners, we have in the studio two representatives from the farming community. One, Mr. Richardson from the Guav Road Farmers, and Shiraz Khan from the Farmers Association. And of course, we have Jermaine Oliver of the Landowners Group. And that's another story which, in fairness to you, I think is outside of your remit. That is for the government to deal with. In fairness to you. See, I'm trying to be fair.
Mm-hmm.
Good.
I appreciate that.
So the farmers are saying in specific that you have never approached them in any form or fashion.
Yes, we have, and we told them as well, look, we want to develop the Chagaramas area because we see there are opportunities for development, opportunities for thousands
of agricultural
jobs.
Is agricultural development not development?
Agriculture, the Ministry of Agriculture has land in Chagaramas,
mm-hmm.
and they are doing research as well as cultivation on it.
So is it that the Guav Road Farmers are on Chagaramas Convention Center, etc. lands?
I am not aware that they are on the Convention Center lands.
And why are you pushing them off?
I am not pushing them off. Nobody's cultivating on the Convention Center land.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you're
so
mixing
is there,
it up.
Is, no, I'm not but mixing it up.
I'm not aware of anybody.
64-acre plot of land. Have you intervened there at all? And by you, I mean the Chagaramas Development Authority.
Are you referring to Grove Road?
Yes, yes.
Right, that is not the Convention Center land.
Okay, fine. I know that.
What we have done is we have engaged them from beginning to end
mm-hmm.
by initially telling them, look, we want to develop the area. And as a matter of fact, we did an audit of who was present on the land at the time. And we found solutions for people who were living there, as well as people who were doing a little gardening, a little small gardening. But at no point in time were there any extensive farming going on in Guav Road.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That only started when we give them the notice telling them that we have plans for development.
When was this?
That was in November
2013.
You gave them the notice?
Yes, they got the notice.
Mm-hmm.
And at the end of the period, we informed them that we were going to start developing and preparing the lands for development. We started to do that, and they took us to court,
mm-hmm.
saying that we're breaking down their stuff. The CDA then decided they are deserving of due process. So we held our hand and we allowed the whole process to go through the courts.
Mm-hmm.
The judge and the court decided that CDA was in the right in the way it was done, the process it was done, the way the land was being prepared, and everything that I was doing, we did it the proper way. And that included consultation. And if the court is saying that, look, the CDA did what we were supposed to do, and you're not entitled to be here, you need to move off of the land.
When was that judgment delivered?
That judgment was delivered last July.
July 1st, 2014.
And who was the judge?
High Court Justice Ronnie Budu Singh.
Ronnie Budu
Singh, okay. Yeah.
Just let me do this little thing for our listeners to be able to send in messages. Steve has his own up there, and I have a little thing here that I'm not tech savvy, so my son helped me do this thing so that we get some responses. Join the discussion on Shagaramas via Twitter using the hashtag HardTalk, tweet at Tony Fraser TT. And I'll read some of your messages for you. Right, Steve? And how do they get in touch
I'm
with
impressed.
The station? You're impressed.
I'm impressed.
But I admitted up front that that wasn't me.
It was your son.
It was my son.
All right.
I don't have those skills.
You don't?
No.
Well, I'm sure you do. It's there somewhere. You can send us your text messages at 1021. You type the word talk, leave a space at the message. We'll get it immediately in the studio. And that's for B mobile phones only. And, of course, those on the World Wide Web at power102fm.com or instant studio messenger service. And I hope you all are on the road listening on our app. And iTunes and Play Store, just look for power102fm in Trinidad. Tony?
Yes, thank you. And we have in our studios, we have Kizzy, see where my mind went to. Kizzy Riz, who is the communications manager of the Shagaramas Development Corporation, and Peter Neptune, who is the marketing manager. And they are here to talk about Shagaramas, not only the convention center, but so on and so on. We have somebody who wants to get in one time.
Well, no, I didn't open the lines up, but I want to let people know the National Insurance Board of Trinidad and Tobago wishes to advise that the Barataria Civic Center is closed for business today, Tuesday, April 7th. Normal business hours resume tomorrow, Wednesday, 8th April. The NIBTT apologizes for any inconvenience and encourages its customers to visit another conveniently located civic center or contact the NIBTT at 663-4NIS. That's 663-4NIS. That number is 4647 for assistance. Tony.
Thank you very much, Steve. I have a cough and a flu that are attacking me, so excuse me up front. So, we go back to the farmers.
Yeah, so
yes, you wanted to finish something.
Yeah, so if a judge reviewed all the data, all the information, and decided that there were no grounds for the farmers to have what they want to have to the detriment of the rest of Trinidad and Tobago, why can't we be a lawful country and follow the law? That is what we are saying.
Mm-hmm. Was there any human consideration? The farmers have said that they've been on
certainly.
The land for over 50, over 60
years. I'll give you some stories. There were three people who were squatting on the land. They were living there. And two of them, we were able to secure separate accommodation for them. And a third one, their family came and took them away and said, look, we don't want you living in this kind of squalor, and we're going to keep you. And that person has also been entitled for an old age pension because he's over 65 years old. So he was able to fund himself, and his family is helping him out. So we did not go in there as it is being depicted by these people, with bulldozers and cutlasses and hacked everything away.
You mean the farmers? You're not going to call them people in that.
Well, I am not sure what farmers call. I will respect them. But I will not call what they're doing farming also.
Mm-hmm.
Prior to about a year ago, we had a media tour. We provided a media tour of the whole area. And when they look around, they say, but what farming are we talking about? The media, and that is why they're getting resistance to get the media to come for whenever they have anything. Because the media, we provided them with the information, and they have footage to show that there was no famine going on there.
What are the lands to be used for under the CDA?
The land is very important to enable the development of the Williams Bay area. Right now, the traffic is passing through right in the middle of a very crowded area, where people park on one side of the road and they cross the road to go to the beach. It is a very dangerous situation. And I don't know if last year or year before you would have read about accidents happening around that very sharp bend where people lost their lives.
So in other words, a road is going to cut through the area?
Yes, the road is going to go straight. Instead of going through the land, it's going to go straight and come straight around into Makarib and allow development to continue there, as well as make that whole area a pedestrian area.
So they wouldn't have the fear of a truck passing or a car passing and knocking them.
Do you think that is maximum use? A road is a vital piece of infrastructure for development, but what about food? That's important too. Food,
Tony, sometime later on this month, the CDA will be launching, or we have consultations for a master plan we would have developed. And the master plan is basically a 15-year developmental plan for the Chagaramas area. And part of the master plan treats with agriculture, but agriculture in a more sustained manner, a more sustainable, controlled manner.
Will the Guavood farmers get some kind of inside road tools?
Let me ask you a question. Are the Guavood farmers citizens of Trinidad and Tobago?
I'm sure they are.
And all development in Chagaramas is to benefit the citizens of Trinidad and Tobago.
I'm talking about
Tony, once the opportunity exists, then they are welcome and they will be part of whatever opportunity exists.
My question is, if they are going to get any first preferences, having been on the land for 50 years?
When we started the consultations.
I'm
answering that question.
Yes.
The farmer, the people who we identify who were operating there, we provided them their names to the Ministry of Agriculture.
Mm-hmm.
And they will be contacted soon about where they can farm.
So there is some
preference. So we have not totally ignored them at all.
Okay.
They have been accommodated by the Ministry of Agriculture.
Yes.
And a plan for that development and development of agriculture throughout the country, they will be incorporated into that.
Okay, so we're going to have, just for our listeners' we're going to have the farmers are here inside the room, but we have an arrangement and they're going to say their piece afterwards. So they're going to respond, they are looking at them and they're taking copious notes of what you're saying, and we're going to get them to respond to that. You know, there was a judgment by Justice Sipasad, I think, Frank Sipasad. We're talking about transparency and access to information. And the judge ruled in the Invaders Bay matter that the minister had to cough up the information about the advice that he had got from some senior counsel somewhere. It's indicative, to my mind, of what a high court judge, is saying about transparency. Transparency after the fact is something else. It is not transparency. It is that you have decided and then you're beating us into condition to accept what you have given.
Now, what is public is the process and the criteria for selecting someone.
Mm-hmm.
And when that person is selected and we have accepted the criteria for selecting them, when the person has been selected, you go back and you look at the criteria and see whether they meet it or not.
Not as you, but why do you
that is
the
transparency
to
you. You can't quantify all of the information while you're in the middle of putting it together.
Why not? That is a status quo.
That is not
quo.
Done anywhere else in the world.
Negotiating
rights for drilling or rights for
the kings and queens of the world going back 500 years have sat down and established the status quo which we are all following, and we have not questioned it. We are at the point in the history where we have to question everything, because often we see the outturn is against the national interest. That is the reality in the gas arrangements. For years, people have my good friend Hamid, can't remember, legal, died in his grave arguing about what is the compensation from the gas to the population of Trinidad and Tobago. It has now become semi-transparent. So that saying that is the process all over the world doesn't faze me. I am saying that we have to have a new order where information is really transparent and people have a determination to make in this whole process.
Understood.
And therefore, I don't know how we can accept this. This is prime country, prime part of the country, and you are negotiating. This is the CDA, and I come back and I apologize to Peter and Kizzy, nice people, and they've thrown you all into the heat, and I'm not attacking you, but I'm saying that the process of transparency has to change, and that people have to know who they're getting in bed with. Who are these people? Who are these investors? Are they Are they pumping money into a government political campaign? Those are the questions. Are they drug dealers who are putting money in campaigns? I didn't invent that. You know, is it politicians who say, one party say, them fellas getting drug money. Them fellas say, I didn't invent that. Transparency is the name of the game. Let's get them some questions, Steve. But let's go to, give me a flavor of the bird now.
Multination. You want a flavor of the bird.
And go out.
Of all little nation is not a lot, but oh, what a mixture of races and culture, that's what we've got. Still no major indifference of race, color, religion or finance. It's amazing to you, I'm sure, we didn't get independence before, which means...
And what Sparrow is singing about there, believe it or not, encapsulates all of this. Colonialism gone. Our nation is born, nation of people of Trinidad and Tobago. We followed our leaders. We used to believe that long time.
We're going to aspire, we're going to be a success.
The National Insurance Board of Trinidad and Tobago wishes to advise that the Barataria Civic Center is closed for business today, Tuesday, April 7th. Normal business hours resumes tomorrow, Wednesday, 8th April. The NIBTT apologizes for any inconvenience and encourages its customers to visit another conveniently located service center or contact us at 663-4NIS. That's 663-4647 for assistance.
Election Hard Talk with journalist Tony Fraser will return in a moment.
National Humor Monarch is comedy and calypso humor, Pecong and Bacchanal in the Grandstand, Queen's Park, Savannah, on Saturday, 11th April 2015, showtime 8 p.m. As eight singers challenge the incredible Myron B. in the finals for the title of Humorous Calypso Monarch. Is Bacchanal and Commerce, Pecong and Humor at its best, with MCs Tommy Joseph and Damian Melville. With more Bacchanal with Relator, Funny and Sheldon Nugget. Music by Len Cummings and the Wailers. The Humorous Calypso Final, Saturday, 11th April 2015, Grandstand, Queen's Park, Savannah. Tickets advance $200 and $250 at the door. Available at Cleves, Crosby, CN San Fernando, and all Tuco offices. Dress up, come out, and laugh!
It's fun time at the Living Water Community's Grand Family Fiesta. Sunday, 12th April, at the Princess Elizabeth Center grounds, Port of Spain, from 9 a.m. Kids, play and ride all day long in the kids' zone. Take photos with Queen Elsa and Anna. Enjoy bingo, Wheel of Fortune, and lots of other stalls. Tasty cuisine at our food fest, and tickets available for delicious Sunday lunch. Come to the Living Water Grand Family Fiesta, Sunday, 12th April, Princess Elizabeth Center.
This Sunday, experience it once again.
Turn it up, turn it up.
The most unique Reggae Sunday. Reggae on the Avenue. Jamming at the Coco Lounge. Ladies pay no cover, and everyone drinks free before 11 p.m. with premium drink specials all night thereafter.
Stepping out on your own, got a heart made of stone. Such a cold, cold girl.
Reggae on the Avenue. This and every Sunday at the Coco Lounge.
I know, sir, it's all about reggae on the Avenue.
How much I need you, would you come tonight?
Reggae on the Avenue.
Won't you come over, love?
This Sunday, experience it once again. Reggae on the Avenue, sponsored by Corfacier. Reggae on the Avenue is endorsed by V2 Promo.
Come on!
We now return to Election Hard Talk with journalist Tony Fraser on Power 102 FM. Your voice, your vote.
All right, at this time, we want to open up our telephone lines at 222-TALK, 222-8255. Of course, you could also send us a text message, Be Mobile, at 1021. Type the word TALK, leave a space, send a message. We will get it immediately in studio. Same thing on those on the World Wide Web at power102fm.com. Of course, you call us 222-TALK, and we do have a call online. Good afternoon. Good afternoon.
Hello?
Yes, go ahead, please.
Okay, I have a question. I don't know if my question is within any purview of your guest, but I want to ask it anyway. In 1928, my grandfather purchased 225 acres of land in Shagram. It was then leased to the colonial government for 99 years during World War II. Then, when we became independent, it was passed to our local government. What happens when that lease is up? Does that land go back to the original owners?
Thank you very much. I don't know if the CDO officials here are really not in a position to respond to that. Even I would break for them in such circumstances. I'm not wont to doing that, but I will do that. Seriously, though, that is obviously a response that is required from the government. And in that respect, we know that the landowners, my good friend, former late Augustine Noel petitioned, he went here, there, and everywhere. He was fearless in making that argument wherever he went to. Steve, I got a little tweet here. I'm proud to do these things.
All right, let me
Nigel Barry Mahabia tweeted, always something with this government, relocating people, Guava Road farmers, Point 14 Highway, ex-Caroni workers, and failure. That's his statement.
All right, let's take another call at 222 Talk. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Beautiful job, Tony.
Yes, sir.
Keep pressing, because there are a lot of issues there. Because what is going to happen after that 30 years? Most likely there is a renewal. So 30 years is tantamount to ownership. Don't be fooled. They have come there to camouflage the nonsense that is going on down there. So keep pressing, and the solution to that whole peninsula, turn it into a national park with the requisite legislation and controls. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
And Tony, I just want to respond. In fact, part of the master plan, our master plan and developmental plans for Shagram, speaks to development of a national park. And one thing I also want to address is people, there's the belief that we are affecting the environment, we're going to cut down all the trees, we're going to build up everywhere in Shagram. Based on the master plan, what I can tell you is only 11% of all the land in Shagram is going to be built. 52% of the land is going to be is considered a protected area, and the other 30% is actually buffer zone. And everything that is being done in Shagram is being based on the existing environment and based on sustaining the environment in within the respect of developing a national park. And all this information will be revealed later on this month when we have our consultation for the master plan and eventually the launch of the master plan.
Will that consultation be true consultation, meaning that you can gather us to talk, like the political parties? They say they hold a consultation and they talk all the time and they don't listen to anybody. Is that going to be open for feedback and meaningful consultation?
I believe that, and in fact,
you're not too sure.
No, I believe it.
What you believe and what is the reality can be different.
It will be open to feedback, and that's why we are having a consultation.
And implementation of good ideas that may come forward.
And in fact, throughout the development.
Yes, Kizzy.
Yes, Tony. And in fact, throughout the development of the entire master plan, there has been ongoing consultation.
Consultation.
Yes. The intention.
You know, consultation in the Constitution, as determined by Sir Ellis Clark, is that I listen to you and thank you for your views and I go and do what I want to do. That's the legal definition. He's a constitutional lawyer, not me. And I'm just simply quoting him.
But let me reinforce, Tony, that there's a master plan. The intention for the development of the Shagram region is very people-centered. We are trying to ensure that all our projects benefit the citizens of Trinidad and Tobago. For example, if you look at the boardwalk, the recent launch of phase two of the boardwalk, when you go up to Shagram, the people leave from all over Trinidad to utilize the facilities. When we do the amusement park, every citizen in Trinidad and Tobago will have access to that amusement park. And all our projects are geared towards...
So, Kizzy, I could be cynical now, you know. It is fine. Allow the natives to walk up and down the boardwalk. But the real cash cow, the convention center, is owned by people we don't know, phantom figures in the night.
I, 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 I won't use the term phantom, and as I said, we
Lee were... Fork, you know Lee Fork, or you're too young to know Lee Fork?
Probably too young.
Lee Fork, Lee Fork was the author of Phantom.
Probably too young.
The Ghost Who Walks.
So look out for the consultation, Tony, coming up, and you would
right, let me come
care
back,
about the...
Let me come back to a critical thing, because I need a response on this. There is said to be that the... And Andy Johnson wrote it in a column saying that there is to be a return to Trinidad and Tobago after the 30-year lease. Mm-hmm. Yes? What are to be the conditions by which the owners or the managers, whatever you choose to call them, investors, will return the property back to the government of Trinidad and Tobago?
Tony, we will not know the specifics of that. When the project is launched, we will have all the information about it.
Cat in bag, I call that.
Not, no, I would not say so. Like I said before...
Sorry, cat is a bad word. I take that back.
Most certainly.
Some kind of animal,
just say bag.
Domestic animal in bag.
No, you have to... Start with the right process in the first place.
My problem, you know, Peter and Kizzy, and really, I am talking to Danny Solomon and Miss Hargraves, and eventually the minister, who is the minister, Botewari. Mm-hmm. Eventually, Botewari, you all have
will
to
get
come.
Your answer.
No, we need the participation. We need the transparency. This property. After this government goes, and I'm not making any prediction about the election, even if this party comes back into power, after this government goes and the next government goes, the land and the facilities belong to the people of Trinidad and Tobago, and they have to have a say in it. They absolutely have to have a say in this matter. And you can't arrive at agreements and then say that we want to consult with you. That's craziness, total craziness. We're into a different era. Absolutely.
You see,
I do hold you responsible, Peter. You have to bat and hold your bat straight and your batting in your crease.
Thank you very much.
I don't want the pressure.
In the negotiating process, for example, you have set criteria and someone come forward and they've met all the criteria.
But the point is that the people of Trinidad and Tobago don't trust you. Whoever the government is, the people of Trinidad and Tobago are saying that that's why we've had successive government changes going back to 1986. Every 5 years, sometimes under 5 years, the people are saying, listen, we are not happy with how you're managing our property, and therefore we have to change you. That is the writing on the wall. You know, and that's the reality of the situation. But do we have other people? Sorry, I'm going on for too long.
All right, let's take a couple of calls. 222-8255. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Can I get into the talk show?
You're on live. Go ahead. Tell us where you're calling from.
Oh, okay. Hello?
Yes, go ahead. Listen to us on the telephone.
Yes, I'm not turning on your radio.
Please.
Okay, good afternoon to everyone there. And firstly, I must state how very, very happy I am for this program. I'm happy that there's a journalist who's willing to ask questions until he gets honest and satisfactory answers. So to Mr. Fraser, you're doing this on behalf of many, many voices of Trinidad and Tobago. Okay, two short questions, right? Ms. Kizzy, she started to list out, like, back in February 2013, that there were ads to have RFPs for repairs. When were the ads placed on RSPs for the leasing of the property? And then secondly, if persons of the CDA and the government choose to disclose to the public who are the investors only after the deal is totally closed, if as a citizen of Trinidad and Tobago, I discover that there's probably some sort of nepotism or that the investor is actually a party financier, what am I supposed to do at that point in time as a citizen of Trinidad and Tobago? Thank you.
Thank you very much, and the lady could not have said it better. She is, I am only here as a mouthpiece, you know. Forget Tony Fraser, you know. The lady has come and articulated the position. Who are these people? How can you tell us after the fact? The lady is saying that governance has to mean that we are participating in it. All over the world it's happening. The Arab sheikhs at one point in time felt that they had a smooth road to go through. People have determined differently. So, do you want to answer the lady, Kizzy?
I can answer the question on the dates for you. As I said, on the 5th of February 2013, the first invitation was issued in the public domain seeking proposals for qualified experienced investors to develop the Chagrammas Hotel and Convention Center. The original advertisement was extended until May 31st, 2013. No, sorry. The original advertisement provided May 31st, 2013 as the deadline. This was further extended to the 29th of July, 2013. Following the deadline, a total of four companies expressed interest, but only one submission was received, but did not meet the qualifying requirements. Thereafter, several advertisements were placed in the media. The CDA utilized the magazines. We went through foreign embassies to seek prospective developers as well and investors. However, no investor committed. After that, we also engaged the services of InvestTT to promote the many investment opportunities available on the peninsula, which also included the Chagrammas Hotel and Convention Center. Once again, no investor committed. So I think the CDA would have tried and would have explored numerous options to get investors. And that is why we had to also adopt the joint venture approach, because it requires a lot of capital investment. One, because of the condition of the hotel and convention center.
And we need markets all around the world.
And also
and that is quite understandable.
And the skill set and expertise to develop the hotel and convention center to ensure that it's profitable.
And you need food to supply the guests. You know, one of the major, I know something about tourism, and one of the major leakages from hotels, I've been all over the I cover tourism quite a lot. I've been all over the region in tourism conferences and so on, and one of the major leakages out has to do with food. I remember going to a friend, a journalist, a colleague and myself, we went to a major hotel in St. Lucia, and we asked, where the bourgeois and bake? And it's only a dry fry egg in your tail, and so on. So that the food has to be incorporated into this. Up to this morning, I heard the agricultural woman, I don't remember her name, saying that we have a $4 billion food bill. And we have farmers in Guavro. They show me some big BG planting that they, you know about big BG planting? Mm-hmm. It's so satisfying, especially when hot. Lord knows I'm suffering for BG planting. You should know that, Kizzy. Sparrow in his prime.
Yes.
Shouting for BG planting, but that's only an aside. Go ahead, Steve.
All right. 222-TALK, 222-8255. We have another call online. Good afternoon. Where are you calling from?
Good afternoon. Steve, Tony and guests,
yes,
listeners. I am calling from Waterhole, Cockerit. I did not hear all of the program, and I had to lower my radio, should in case I get through. So I miss Kizzy, I think it is her name.
Kizzy Ruiz.
The answer she was given to the convention center. To what I heard, I want to say thank you, Tony Fraser, the penetrating question, very deep. It is so concise, and the answers that is coming forth from the gentleman there is not going anywhere. It leaves more questions to be asked than the answers that he's given. I don't understand how he doesn't know certain have the answers for certain questions that Tony is asking him for. Who is the finance? Who is the persons that this the land would be given to develop it? CDA must have more than what they are giving out. And as a nation, a republic nation, we must get more. This project must stop. It must be halted. And more information must be given broadly to the people. Yes, I understood that you said something about the Gore farmers. If ever a time that we need people, and I think Sharaz is there, if I pronounce his name correctly, if ever a time that we need to have the land planted and to have more production in food, is now. Therefore, the answers concerning the farmers and where the judge said that he gave some in the courts, he gave in favor of the CDA. That must be reopened. It must be reopened. You know why? We are going to find ourselves in trouble. I know about the produce of that area. I've been into that area since, I forget his name now, the gentleman down there. I think it's Mr. Noel.
Augustine Noel.
He used to come all to Cocorite,
yes,
to plead with us.
Right.
And why I'm concerned, you are saying that it would be opened and we will have access and this and that. I'm saying no. I am saying this is not true. I take it from the point. We who live in Cocorite Waterhole, we had access to go into the sea where they put up these houses right there by the walkover. We had access before they ever came there. When Dr. Eric Williams moved the houses from the road that is now coming straight up, that flyover and all of that, there were houses there. We had access. When those houses there, but they put them up there, all access was blocked to the people for Cocorite. And one last thing, is there any procedure for the, we are talking local, we are talking people, is there the people, the Baptist people, they go there regularly to baptize people. You are saying that we'll be able to have access to the sea coast there.
All right, thank you. Are we going to get some responses from them?
This thing must be brought back to the public.
Thank you, Archbishop.
No, thank you very much.
All right.
Any access will be allowed to the Baptists to go into the area to baptize their people?
Of course, yes. Access to the beach is guaranteed under the
Constitution. That is part of the culture.
Yes.
And that's part of people's habits. And indeed, sometimes we don't know what attracts tourists, but I am sure that is something that attracts tourists.
Yes.
As I say, I go to some salt islands in the Caribbean. I'm bad talking them. They only have salt on the land, but they have 300,000 people passing through. All of the created attractions for people. But, you know, both this last caller and the caller before, they are making the point, and the one before made the point very strongly, that suppose you sell one of the investors, or any number of them, are party financiers who have been under scrutiny for raiding the treasury and making sweetheart deals with governments, plural, over the years. Suppose this property falls into their hands. After the fact, people can shout forever and ever, and that won't change the price of cocoa, you know?
No, you see, the development in Chaguaramas is really opening up Chaguaramas to the people.
Yeah.
We understand the importance Chaguaramas plays in the matrimony of the country. And everything about it, including the history, including the environment, all of that, we understand the importance of the environment in it. So that...
But people don't trust you.
Well,
and this is not something particular to you, Peter.
Mm-hmm.
This is something peculiar to authority. The reality is that people are not trusting authority, institutions and authority figures. That is very clear.
But that is a different issue. And
but it's
important.
Crucial.
It is important.
Yes.
And maybe we need to do more to show how our strong institutions are defending the people and actually acting in the interest of the people.
All right, let's take some more calls.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon, Tony.
Yes, good afternoon, sir.
Very good job. But I want you to get these two people's number, their contact numbers, and give it to Tommy Joseph, because he's looking for some comedians.
All right, we're not going that direction. Let's have some serious discussion here. Sorry, what? 222 talk, 222-8255, please. I think you have enough material with elections around the corner. You have enough material.
I was following the band carefully, you know.
So was I.
No, right. but you know what? Okay, he went a little bit too far, but that's the kind of feeling that you're getting from people. That's not me. I am driven. I've told people that I've been a reporter and journalist for 35 years, and I have never come out of a program with somebody complimenting me for it. They always say, "Boy Fraser, you sell out to them people because they think we are soft." Mm-hmm. So what I am doing is really articulating what people feel about these matters.
All right, we have another call. Good afternoon. Where are you calling us from?
Good afternoon, gentlemen. I'm calling from the Cape area.
Go ahead.
First of all, I picked up parts of the show. Right? I picked up the part where they're arguing about transparency. So let's get this straight. Unless the population has sight of every aspect of that deal with local authorities as well as the so-called private investors, there is no transparency. If you cannot say who they are, then we don't have oversight. There cannot be transparency. There is no argument where that is concerned. Leave that as it is. There is no transparency. So, Tony, I agree with you. Sucker, CD, your name is Development Authority, right? I'm not quite sure if I missed this part of the conversation, but given sense disease, it should arise. What is the CDA doing about infrastructure in terms of road development? If your mandate is to develop, because look at what is going on, especially over the weekend. It took people, some cases, 2-3 hours to get out of Sharamas last night. When Wasa was doing work on the road, so that means you come down from a dual carriage to a single lane to shape on two directions. But yet you're so-called doing these quote-unquote developments in Sharamas. What are they doing to ensure that the traffic or the movement of people cannot be inhibited because of the increased volumes? Right now you're putting everything down inside of a hole. Okay. Right now there's no development or infrastructure. Even if people who live there are being affected by it, how are they supposed to now live proper lives? It's because there's some little concept down in Sharamas.
Okay, sir.
The entire area.
Thank you very much. Let's get some Thank responses you. From him. Peter.
Over the weekend,
the questions of access
sure.
and egress from the area.
Over the weekend, we had police presence along the Western Main Road into Carinage. The traffic was inhibited by some works that was being done by Wasa. But really, the development and the activities that was going on in Sharamas area, traffic in and out of that area was very, very smooth. And we were also very disappointed about that development that was going on with Wasa. However, you must understand that our jurisdiction ends by Alcoa. And what we are doing is avidly improving the infrastructure within the Sharamas Peninsula, and access in and around there will be drastically improved by the projects that we are doing. And in addition to that, we are also encouraging, and we have been supporting the government's efforts at providing alternative access to Sharamas, and that includes using the waterways, as well as transportation in and out of Sharamas in busy times. We have police and traffic wardens and so on all along the way, and that has been working pretty well, except when we have these little interjections by Wasa.
Can I interject and ask sure. one question as you're dealing with traffic? One carnival fair in O2 Park, mm-hmm. but yet it took people 3 hours. You had, and you said that CDA has jurisdiction until Alcoa, mm-hmm. but yet you there were no officers around, no CDA police around. There were cars coming out of the peninsula heading towards Digo Martin using the westbound lanes.
And
that created total gridlock and 3 hours. And that was just one fare to get out. My question to you, do you all negotiate with the Carinage Police Department and, should I say, the Commissioner, Assistant Commissioner of Police, in order to facilitate ways of moving traffic faster in and out?
Most certainly we do.
On every instance?
On every instance. You must also be aware that traffic is everywhere in Trinidad and Tobago, not just by us. When we got traffic yesterday and over the weekend, there was also traffic in Maracas going into there.
So
there's
question,
also traffic in other parts of the country.
The question I have is,
so that
is CDA concentrating on the infrastructure, the road infrastructure into and out of the area, as a precursor to the development that is going on, the plan for the area.
Most certainly. And the way development
works... Most certainly when it's coming.
No, I'm telling you, the way development works all around the world is that you have the demand for access and infrastructure, and government follows and they build it. You had the traffic jam first, leading by Ura Butler, before they build the extra interchange.
Okay.
So you must have a little bit of pressure, and then it responds.
All right,
and
folks,
the government is in high gear right now, putting the things in place to deal with that.
Right.
And you will hear announcements on that show.
So you've said a lot, and we've given you all of the opportunity. This was supposed to be a joint program. So we want to give the farmers an opportunity to come and say their piece now. In going, the farmers have heard you said that they are right here and they're hearing. They don't need me to repeat it, but I repeat it for our listeners, that they never had contact with you. You never had contact with them. They woke up one morning and they saw their figs on the ground and whatever else, and they think it's very unfair.
Well,
yes, that's the story.
We
have been in consultation with people who have been really interested in agriculture in Chagaramas, and will continue to support them.
All right. And you can tell your principals, Mr. Daniel Solomon, his grandfather never ran from a political fight, and we are always here ready and willing to entertain him here. If you're going to deal with public property, who is Daniel Solomon? Who is Tony Fraser? We are nothing in this. This is not an ego thing on my part. This is something to give people information. You've heard the callers and hear what they're saying. So anytime he's ready to come himself and justify to the country is that you're going ahead with your plans without real consultation, meaningful consultation with the population, and you don't, and the population doesn't find itself faced with a determination already made, then, you know. But we thank you for coming, and we don't attack you personally, and we say, Kizzy, I hope you have a good song next year, a song or two. And I prefer, yes, my dear lady.
Next year will be good. Don't worry.
All right, wonderful. I'm not disrespecting your role in CDA, but it's a kaiso man to my heart, you know, and a kaiso man go say it how you say it. Yeah, what's Paro say?
Yeah.
Model nation at last. Thank you for coming.
And, thank you for having
listen
us.
Listen to the farmers as they have their peace. Thanks a lot, Kizzy.
Thank you.
All right. Taking a quick break before we go, I'll let you know the National Insurance Board of Trinidad and Tobago wishes to advise that the Barrett Area Service Center is closed today, Tuesday, April 7th. Normal business hours resumes tomorrow, Wednesday, 8th April. The NIBTT apologizes for any inconvenience and encourages its customers to visit another conveniently located service center. Or you can contact the NIBTT at 663-4-NIS. That's 663-4647 for assistance.
Hard Talk with journalist Tony Fraser will return in a moment.
Munchkins ice cream, Munchkins ice cream. You'll want a tasty, creamy treat. Munchkins ice cream, Munchkins good for one.
Delicious.
Better bite.
I want some.
It's best when we in a line with me and with you.
Come on.
Munchkins ice cream, Munchkins ice cream.
Real
so
good.
Tasty, so creamy. Munchkins ice cream.
Munchkins. Gotta have it today.
Tune in every Wednesday morning from 10:30 for Staying Safe. Staying Safe. A proactive approach to crime prevention on Power 102 FM. Learn how you can heighten your awareness, boost your confidence, increase your overall safety, completely safe, and enhance your home, business, and personal security. Remember, your safety is your business. Staying Safe. Staying Safe. A problem-oriented and solution-driven program. Wednesdays at 10:30 a.m. on Power 102 FM.
Sponsored by Be Will and Company Limited.
every Tuesday. Tune in to Power 102 FM for Indigenous from 8:30 p.m. The only full spectrum interactive music program featuring the Indigenous Top 12, hosted by the Artist Coalition of Trinidad and Tobago in collaboration with the Sunday Mix artists, fans, and B-Mobile, TNT's number one mobile network.
If I told you the truth.
We now return to Election Hard Talk with journalist Tony Fraser on Power 102 FM. Your voice, your vote.
All right, and once again, we'll inform you, the National Insurance Board of Trinidad and Tobago wishes to advise that the Barataria Civic Center is closed for today, Tuesday, April 7th, for normal business hours. It will resume tomorrow, Wednesday, April 8th. The NIBTC apologizes for any inconvenience and encourages customers to visit another conveniently located Civic Center or contact 663-4NIS, that's 663-4647. Tony?
Thank you very much, Steve. And we heard a moment ago the case of the Chagaramas Development Authority. We have in the studio now the farmers who have been actually in the Guava Road area, Joseph Richardson. We have Mr. Shiraz Khan, who is from the Farmers Association. What's the official name of it?
Trinidad and Tobago Farmers Union.
Trinidad and Tobago Farmers Union. And we have Jermaine Oliver of the Landowners Association, the people who have been petitioning for a return of the land which was leased during the period of World War II to the Americans by the British colonial authorities in occupation of power at that point in time. I have some questions. I'm coming to you, Mr. Richardson, directly. The lady has said, and the gentleman have said, that there have been consultations.
Good day, Trinidad and Tobago. I mean, it was hard for me to sit behind there, I would tell you, Mr. Fraser, and take that from Peter Neptune. It was very, 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 very hard. But I would tell you, and I say it again.
I'm glad you restrained yourself.
I would tell you.
Thank you.
Yes, yes, I'm a person, you know, quick to react sometimes, but I couldn't do it now. I would tell you, you know, Peter Neptune must stop doing this. I know it's a job he is doing, but there are people outside there, not
so
me.
So were there consultations or
never
not?
Never happened. The only...
Did they write you?
There was confrontation, not consultation. There was confrontation. The photographs, while he was talking, I was holding up the photographs with him in the land where he was part of the team who bulldozed. They came in the middle of the night. They break down the sheds in March. And then on the 23rd of February, he was also on the ground directing the men with cutlasses and whatnot, chopping down the plants. We have the photographs. We have them on video. He is still saying that it never happened.
So you were going to say the only something, and I stopped you.
The only thing we had was confrontation, not consultation.
So is it that Mr. Neptune was telling the truth, that there was not consultation?
You know, there's a thing with children, you will tell them, because I know there might be a lot of children home, and they would say, don't say a lie, they say an untruth. Well, you know.
Okay, what about the second part? He said this matter went to court and the judge gave a ruling that the Guava Road farmers really had no entitlement to the land.
That was wrong. That the transcript of the court will not say what he is saying there. What happened was in one of the photographs you will see where one morning we got up and we saw three fields, over 4,000 planting trees chopped down that morning, that Sunday morning. And that happened right here recently. Right? And what I'm saying is we took the matter, it was an injunction that we filed, and in that injunction, we decided to, we took the matter to court. That injunction, and it so happened the judge ruled the information that came to the judge was false too. We had a lot of false information passed because the thing about it with the court, they say what they have to say, and we can't say anything. We have to wait until it is said, and then our lawyers are supposed to counter. We have found something going on, but I wouldn't mention it here right now pertaining to, you know, representation. But what I would say here now is that the court ruled that the CDA had put out how much a substantial amount of money into this development plan, and they're saying that what they put out is much more than what we are worth. technically, something like that the judge was saying. I can't quote exactly.
But the bottom line of the ruling, was it that you had no business being on the land?
No, it wasn't like that at all. It was one person, Philo Jensen Martin. He was the one who got chopped down. He was the one who took them, who took the injunction out against them. The rest of the farmers exist, and they were there. The judge had no knowledge or no information before the judge of other farmers. So the other farmers were not part of this injunction, right?
Are you going to take it up legally?
Yes, we are, right? The other farmers were not part of this injunction. The injunction was only about Mr. Philogen St. Martin with his tree fields, over 4,000 planting trees. It so happened that the judge even told them, your lawyers, talk to the man lawyers, which is our lawyers, and come to some agreement for compensation. If you all want the land, you have to compensate the man. They never came back.
One of the other things said by Mr. Neptune is that with regard to the claim that there were this large numbers of farmers cultivating extensive acreage, that it's not so. In fact, you had people who were living on the land, and he, according to him, he told a story that they helped out some people who were squatting on the land. It's really not a big group of farmers.
Mr. Fraser is a total lie. Good? There were people on the land, farmers. Look, Mr. Lett.
There are other ways of saying it.
Yes, I know.
It's not true.
It's on. Believe me, I'm choking on it. Right? Mr. Lett, Anthony, Tony, the whole family, they grew up on that land. I'm talking about since 51. Those are the farmers from 51. Well, you know that.
But answer the question. Yes. Is it a significant number of farmers, or is it two or three farmers?
Look at it this way. We have 20, let's say, we have 15 now with me. That was about 2021. And every one of them had a partner. That is not somewhere around 40 farmers, which I wouldn't call in all the time. Good. Some of the farmers now, one of them turned, two of them died. Good. You have some of them run out because of they're afraid of the ill treatment being issued, the threatening of arrest. The dogs, they are going in there with dogs from a company, Gem Pro Security, right? The CDA officers are arresting. I and all was arrested. So when the farmers see that the king, let's put it that way, the leader is arrested, what do you think will happen to them? It's all a strategy. Right? It's all strategy used. Look, for instance, they said that no significant farming. They come in the middle of the night and bulldoze over 80 acres and then come with their photographers, their media people, and then film it. I said, no significant farming going on here. But we have the photographs. Listen, CDA, if you didn't know, this whole place was photographed before and it's been photographed after you damage it. So we have the photographs, we have the video, so continue damaging. Up to this weekend, you all went down in the wetland. Keep on damaging. We are documented, and these things, all this thing will come to an end soon.
A statement has been made that the farm to be incorporated in the agricultural development that is to go on at Chagaramas.
Where you find that will happen, you bulldoze, chop down for a whole year. I'm talking about over a year now. We're going through this,
I think the argument is that the particular tract that you're talking about, that is open for other forms of development, including road development, and that there are going to be other parts of Chagaramas which will be focused on agriculture. And if you do what is required, then those farmers, your farmers, will obviously be given some form of preferential treatment.
Short here. That is also a lie. Right now, the CADP, they cut the water off of the CADP. They took the shed where the CADP keep their machinery. They took that away. So there's another plan for the CDAP lands in Chagaramas. So they are killing farmers. They want the valley. They want that valley, both the waterfront and the general valley of Tucker Valley, for some exclusive resort. And this thing he's talking about the road, I could run up on that one time. You see that road that they want to block up, and he's talking about accidents. Because of the situation in Chagaramas, there's accident on the whole road from Goodwood Park straight down to Chagaramas. Every day there's accidents. Good? And they are the reason the development plan that doesn't have an additional access road to Chagaramas, that is the reason.
And therefore, what he's saying, he's acknowledging that there are accidents on that one road. And the additional road will take the heat off of that road.
That road, the thing about it is, the road that they're talking about going through the wetland have nothing to do with the traffic. It have to do with them wanting the waterfront because they want to put 21 buildings. You know, to see what I'm wanting to ask them that, you know, what are they putting on the roadway? Because look at right behind me here, right? They are putting 21 buildings on the roadway, on the roadway that exists now, off the boardwalk. It's hotel, restaurant, and casinos. They are there, right? Right now, they are working on that. So they need to get that road in the back, you know, rectified, get that double lane highway running off from the Gore Road, going to Macquarie Road. They need to have that. Once that is in place, then they go to block the road off the beach. And it's not about walking on walkway. There's no walkway here. Look, we have the plan here.
Shiraz.
Yeah, good.
You good.
I sit down there. I don't know. I am a farmer. I delivered some goat making young one before, and it took a lot of patience. And I really, because Steve can't tell me, I had to listen and sit down like a student.
The mics were on.
It's really. Mr. Fraser, Trinidad and Tobago, if you had consultation, then you would have been able to produce a letter today, just like we are producing our photos of confrontation. I have letters of some consultation and trials of sending people letter because there's always telling about protecting a paper trail. If you had that, wouldn't they brought out today? They wouldn't have brought out that today for the people. If you thinking about having farmers involved in your master plan, would you went and develop that first or give them involved into the development plan, into the consultation? I mean to say, we are not fools. They're talking about they're not breaking the law. They broke the law by bulldozing the farmers first of all. And I want to challenge you on something here. The times that they do the bulldozing, the first destruction of the crops was on Carnival Sunday 2014. Every other thing, why did they went in on Good Friday? On Good Friday, the similar thing that they do to 2011 to Dabadi and Dash Trace and Egypt Trace. Good Friday, a day that a majority of the Trinidadians consider it to be a holy day. He called me 6 o'clock in the morning and bulldozing down crops. Is that consultation? Is that law abiding with the law? And is that something of what we are talking about as Trinidadians, all about our people owning something? Is that how we do things? Mr. Fraser, you say you're in the media so long and you ask pertinent questions. Yes. Is that the way we do things as Trinidadians for our property? Is that the way we go in on a Carnival Sunday and on an Easter weekend? Look at that. When people were praying and
maybe they want to avoid confrontation.
Yeah, but on an Easter weekend, you're destroying people's crops. When the media not out and they're saying the media don't want to come because, let me tell you something, yes, there's another set of foolishness there. Is that a good word, foolishness?
Yeah,
that's right. It's not as lying, right?
No,
right,
that's acceptable.
The foolishness that they said is that the people, when they went there, the media, they're disrespecting the farmers by saying they were not planting. Mr. Fraser, who planted a wetland in the dry, in the rainy season? Who plant in the wetland? The man said that last week here. He showed where the bananas was up on the hill and they're planting. And my God, some of the sweetest cucumbers and okra and dashin that we could get came out of that because you know one of the reasons why? They didn't have to irrigate because they're in the wetland. And look, the pictures there to show the amount of dashin. And just 2 weeks ago, we signed an MOU to bring dashin out of Jamaica. Right, and peppers, and we and I don't know have, what is it.
You have blue dashing,
blue metal.
And the
punch is good as goat milk. Eh?
All right. Again, the National Insurance Board of Trinidad and Tobago wishes to advise that the Barataria Civic Center is closed today for business, Tuesday, April 7th. Normal business hours resume tomorrow, Wednesday, April 8th. The NIBTT apologizes for any inconvenience and encourages its customers to visit another conveniently located civic center or contact the NIBTT at 663-4NIS. That's 663-4647 for assistance.
our journey to return to a state of good governance, stability, and integrity in public life continues. Join the People's National Movement for a public meeting on Thursday, April 9th, 7 p.m. at Massey Car Park, St. Augustine. Come and listen to our distinguished political leader, Dr. Keith Rowley, as he sets out his plans to rebuild, restore, and unite our nation.
What I hear you saying is that you want unity. I hear you rejecting racism, nepotism, and hate. What I hear you saying is that you want accountability from your government. You want transparency in all its actions. You want safety, security, and prosperity. And you want to trust your government to serve you, not to rob you.
Come and listen to our platform of powerful speakers. Get to the heart of the burning national issues as we get set for change, meaningful change. We cannot allow the Prime Minister and the UNC to destroy our institutions and national values. Elections must be called now. The PNM is ready to rebuild, restore, and unite. Come to the Massey Stores car park in St. Augustine on Thursday night, 7 p.m. It's time to make it right. Vote PNM.
That was a paid political announcement.
Welcome back to the program. You can still, we still have a few minutes left. Call us, talk to us, send in all of your emails. Steve, what can they do?
While I get my little thing together.
Get into it together.
Yeah.
All right, send us a text. Be mobile. 1021 is the number. You're going to type the word talk, leave a space, then the message. We'll get it in studio. For those on the World Wide Web at power12fm.com, and you know, hundreds of you guys are on a lockdown right now. Instant studio messenger service. Yep, you send it, and we'll get it immediately. Got a message here. Why are amateur photographers constantly harassed by CDA about taking photos? Another guy says the CDA is a law upon themselves and nobody can touch them.
Join the discussion on Shagaramas via Twitter using the hashtag HardTalk. Tweet at Tony Fraser TT. We'll read some of your messages during the program. That's my message to you to get in touch with us to participate. We have Jermaine Oliver, who has been quiet so far, and she was making a reference, I think, in your documentation with regard to the 8 acres of land, and they are encroaching, as you say, upon the owner's land. Go ahead. And
good afternoon, Trinidad and Tobago. We have a lease from the sovereign government at the time for part of the land, that the 8 acres that CD is speaking about. But even before I speak about that, I would like to say something. I was part of a consultation held by CD. At this consultation, ladies and gentlemen, the farmers were kept out by force. People were bussed in. CPEP workers were bussed in. 3 or 4 vehicles of CPEP workers were bussed into that consultation.
When did this happen?
This was the last consultation for the CEC. Joe would have the day there. I was present there. I was one of the people who got into the consultation.
That was in September. So I think it's September the 4th.
So that...
2014?
2014, yes. September.
This should have been a consultation about the interest groups. And one would expect the Wharf Road farmers to fit that bill. The next thing that bothers me is the gentleman sitting and saying that we have traffic all over Trinidad and Tobago. Yes, we have traffic all over Trinidad and Tobago, but it is ridiculous that people in Carnage cannot go out or come in. No family entertainment. You should have seen what went on over the weekend. It was beyond. And it's unfair now to say that, you know, we have traffic all over. We have traffic every day, every minute of the day. I just came up the road here and I had a lot of problems coming out of Carnage for traffic problems, which is not normal for us.
Steve?
All right, give us a call, 222-TALK, 222-8255.
Okay, and we are talking about Shagaramas. You've heard the point of view of the representatives of the Shagaramas Development Authority. And I must say is that... while I respect the right of the CDA to send its representatives, surely the chairman, the chief executive officer, and so on, they have a responsibility to the country to come and put forward their position on such matters. So we continue to open our microphones anytime they wish to come.
Let us know, and we will certainly be quite willing to entertain.
I just want to read something with you,
right,
Tony.
Before you get there, Shah, there's two things. I want to read a message, and then we'll go to our
time.
Good afternoon. Marie sent a message. Good day. And I know the folks at CDA are listening. There was a rumor that the Bamboo Cathedral was going to be cut down to provide a bicycle trail. Okay, that was a rumor. I also heard that rumor.
I think that has been denied by the
city. It has been denied. So there you go, Maria. We have a call. Good afternoon. Where are you calling from?
Yes, hi. Good afternoon. I'm calling from Santa Cruz.
Go ahead.
Yes, I'm from some time involved inside that peninsula there with regards to farming, right? I'm not too many persons said we're just about three farmers, per se, right? That is not true. They actually had farmers there who had shed something inside of there. And just as the gentleman there said, it was knockdown carnival for carnival. During carnival season, it was knockdown 5 in the morning. Also, what I want to speak to is the Chagamas fish market, right?
Yeah.
That fish market was developed at a jetty there by Alcandy. And that was supposed to be the water taxis. They were supposed to come and off-road there, also take people from Carnat in and out of the peninsula. They moved the water taxi down after the heliport. And the water taxi was running with 4 and 5 passengers. I think they have since curtailed that. These are the questions he did need to answer. Right? Why the Chagama fish market not being completed? Right? And the water taxi implemented as was scheduled before. Okay?
Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah.
Yeah, so we just have a couple more minutes, Shiraz.
I just want to ask something, you know. A lot of things have been going on that we're hearing when somebody actually buzz demarked a local phalanx, right? How come something of that nature could be something like $30 million paying $15,000 per year? Let me tell you something. We went to rent a place to have a meeting for one day. We are to pay $15,000 to use the site and down payment of $20,000 to ensure that we leave that in the proper condition for one day. And this was just an area with an old house and them kind. What is happening in Trinidad and Tobago that our sovereignty has shifted from under
our feet? Those things haven't been put up for real public scrutiny. $30 million, that's
but where is it? You said that you're going to give that to the nation at due course. Let me tell you something, and I want to tell you this. This is just coming off of the track a little bit. When this government was in opposition, they were against the Patrick Manning, and I can recall when we were in Chaguanas, we were asking about the lands that was being used for the farm, and in Chagamas came up as an issue when they were purchased 50 greenhouses to set up that whole project with the Cubans and so on. Where are those greenhouses? Each one cost $250,000. Trinidad and Tobago, I ask you, where are those greenhouses that your money, $50 million was spent behind all of those projects? Where have that gone?
All right, let's head to Debe Long Circular. Good afternoon, McDonald.
Good afternoon to everybody in the studio.
Good afternoon.
Now, are you listening to this program with the full set of people all here? And I want to find out how these people could sit down in this studio and tell the nation of Trinidad and Tobago that there were only 3 farmers in Chagaramas planting. And I want to know if they know that the convention center is a historic something to the citizens of Trinidad and Tobago. Those are my 2 questions, thanks.
Thank you very much, sir. And okay, so we've gone some time on this program today and last week, and we are still open to representation by the chairman and the chief executive officer of the Chagaramas Development Authority. Maybe they can provide us with some of their answers and really face some of the questions with regard to accountability and consultation and those things, and not matters that have come or that you plan to tell people. That's not consultation. After the fact, about certain matters. And we will certainly entertain the minister with...
of
Spain, right down there in the Woodbrook area. You could give them a call or place your orders on 385-9814.
That will not okay, because we have to hear all voices for people to make determinations about these matters. If there is anything, any personal position I want to put into this is that there is need for transparency, and I mean
and transparency, honesty.
And accountability before the fact, not after the fact. Steve, let Sparrow have the last word. Thanks.
Sparrow, what a mixture of races and culture, that's what we've got. Color, religion, or finance. It's amazing to you, I'm sure. We didn't get independence.
Your vote.